Well, good morning, everyone, and welcome to First Baptist Church as we gather together to worship our risen Lord and Savior on this, the Lord's Day morning. It is so good to see so many folks here and you folks by the way of the internet, knowing that you're out there, that you love us and you care for us. We want to thank and praise God for all that He has done. This is going to be a challenging couple weeks ahead here as we come to the end of winter, but we rejoice that spring is around the corner and new beginnings and bright hope. I think people are a little bit cheerier when spring gets here. It'll be a short time before the, I guess they're called the crocuses, come up out of the ground, the first ones, and those little snow things. And that kind of gives everybody an uplift in spirits. So as we gather together to worship our Lord and Savior this morning, let's just look to Him in a word of prayer. Gracious Heavenly Father, as we come here this morning, we just thank You, Lord, and praise You that You love us, that You care for us, and that You have the best for us in mind. Even though we go through difficulties and trials and times and ailments, that You are there, that You do provide a way that we find peace and comfort through Your word. It is our prayer, Father, that we would study Your Bible and apply it to our lives and our lives to Your service. We ask that You would guide and direct our church service, our church ministry here in Oxford, that we'd be able to reach out through our missions programs and what we do locally, Father, that people need to know and understand that there is Christ, that they need a Savior, and He can be found if they would just search for Him. So, Father, we pray that folks would open their hearts and their minds and that You would take the blinders off that the devil has put in front of them, that they might clearly see their need for Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. Amen. Pastor Aaron.
Well, good morning. Welcome to First Baptist Church. It's good to see each of you here today. I think I'm on as well, right? Don't feel quite as loud as normal. We're going to start with Amazing Grace. And we sang this just a couple weeks ago, but this is the My Chains Are Gone version as well. But I really love the text of this song. And even the this version of Amazing Grace adds a couple verses to Amazing Grace that are original that we don't always sing. As we sing through this version of it. So let's follow along on the screen. Amazing Grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me.
Amazing Grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now am found, was blind, but now I see. 'Twas grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious did first believe. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior, has ransomed me. And like a flood, His mercy reigns, unending love. Good to me, His word my hope saves. The earth shall soon dissolve like snow. The sun forbear to shine. But God, who called me here below, shall be forever mine. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior, has ransomed me. And like a flood, His mercy reigns. Unending love, amazing grace.
All right, good singing. All right, next we're going to sing off the screen, How Great Thou Art. How great thou art.
Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. When through the woods and forest glades I wander, and hear the birds sing sweetly in the trees, when I look down from lofty mountain grandeur, and hear the brook and feel the gentle breeze, then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. And when I think that God, his Son not sparing, sent him to die, I scarce can take it in, that on the cross my burden gladly bearing, he bled and died to take away my sin. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. When Christ shall come with shout of acclamation and take me home, what joy shall fill my heart. Then I shall bow in humble adoration and there proclaim, my God, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art.
Chuck mentioned we've been working through the book of Job on Wednesday nights, and we made it to Job's friend, the young man Elihu, kind of steps up and says, listen to me, I want to give you some advice. And part of his advice to Job was that God is greater than man. Sort of a phrase that really stuck out to me. And God is greater than man. I think sometimes we forget that. We make man the center of all of our reasoning. We make man the center of our universe. And then we are surprised when man fails us, when man doesn't have the answer. God has always been greater than man. And actually, we're saying, there is a Redeemer, Jesus, God's own Son. Singing. Take your Bibles with me if you would. Colossians chapter 4. It's hard to believe looking back that I started this right around Thanksgiving because one of our first sermons was on being thankful, and thankfulness is definitely a theme that we find in the book of Colossians. Colossians chapter 4, it's the last chapter, and I do have on your handout, your order of service, there's an outline on the back, and it's less of an outline than normal. It's kind of like signposts of the names that Paul mentions as he closes this letter. But we'll look at those folks here in just a minute. You can see on the screen the text as well, or you can follow along in your own Bible. Colossians chapter 4, verses 7 through 18. Start out with an unusual name here, Tychicus. Tychicus will tell you all about my activities. He is a beloved brother and faithful minister, and fellow servant in the Lord. I have sent him to you for this very purpose, that you may know how we are, and that he may encourage your hearts. And with Tychicus I sent Onesimus, our faithful and beloved brother, who is one of you. They will tell you of everything that has taken place here. Aristarchus, my fellow prisoner, greets you, and Mark, the cousin of Barnabas, concerning whom you have received instructions. If he comes to you, welcome him. And Jesus, who is called Justice, these are the only men of the circumcision among my fellow workers for the kingdom of God. Those men were Jews. And they have been a comfort to me. Verse 12, Epaphras, who is one of you, a servant of Christ Jesus, greets you, always struggling on your behalf in his prayers, that you may stand mature and fully assured in all the will of God. For I bear him witness that he has worked hard for you and for those in Laodicea and in Hierapolis. Luke, the beloved physician, greets you, as does Demas. Give my greetings to the brothers at Laodicea and to Nympha and the church in her house. And when this letter has been read among you, have it also read in the church of the Laodiceans, and see that you also read the letter from Laodicea. And say to Archippus, see that you fulfill the ministry that you have received in the Lord. I, Paul, write this greeting with my own hand. Remember my chains, grace, be with you. Grace be with you. Let's open in a word of prayer, please. Our Father in heaven, we thank you for your word. We cannot overemphasize the importance of your word. We see these friendships that Paul holds dearly to his chest, the greetings that he sends, folks from all sorts of different backgrounds, Jews and Gentiles, slaves and free, people that he knows and people that he doesn't. God, we ask that as we look at this list of folks, we consider the relationships that you've put in our life, how you want to use those relationships to minister for your kingdom in this world through our church. God, I thank you for each person here, each person listening in. And I ask that they continue to depend upon you, that our faith grows in times of adversity, that we seek out who we can encourage this week, who we can provide fellowship with this week. God, I thank you for all you've done for us. In Jesus' name, amen. We've made it to the end of the book of Colossians. And at the end of the book of Colossians, we find what one pastor calls a group photograph. The ESV heading reads, "Final Greetings." And we get a glimpse at Paul's friends with whom we're going to see he had various relationships. And as I mentioned when I flipped the handout around, this sermon will, of course, take a little bit different approach than a normal sermon. But this closing text is important. It adds a warm and personal touch to Paul's letter, to a letter that talks about Christology, right? The study of the sufficiency of Jesus Christ, and a letter that addresses false teaching. Further, we get more of a glimpse of Paul's personality, his embrace, his love for these folks, the Christ-centered love that these folks had for one another. My thesis statement's at the top of your outline. The best way to minister the sufficiency of Christ to others is with Christ-centered friends. We see this illustrated in this text for today in Colossians, and we see this truth throughout Scripture as well. Proverbs 27, verse 17 says, "Iron sharpens iron, and one man sharpens another." I love the Old Testament, and really, my favorite thing about the Old Testament is the way that it illustrates the truths that we find in the New Testament. It's Exodus chapter 17, beginning in verse 8, we find a story about Moses and Israel. This is what it says. It says, "Then Amalek came and fought with Israel at Rephidim. So Moses said to Joshua, 'Choose for us men and go out and fight with Amalek. Tomorrow I will stand on the top of the hill with the staff of God in my hand.' So Joshua did as Moses told him and fought with Amalek while Moses, Aaron, and Hur went up to the top of the hill. Whenever Moses held up his hand, Israel prevailed. And whenever he lowered his hand, Amalek prevailed. But Moses' hands grew weary. So they took a stone and put it under him, and he sat on it. While Aaron and Hur held up his hands, one on one side and the other on the other side, so his hands were steady until the going down of the sun. And Joshua overwhelmed Amalek and his people with the sword. With a little help from Moses' friends, Israel was able to win a great victory under his leadership." It's probably important for us to note that there are people out there who do just want to leech off of others. I'm not denying that. And there are people with varying degrees and amounts of resources and abilities. That is true as well. And I would never want to teach my kids that they are not responsible for their own actions. Probably more times than we think that we need the help of others. Maybe we can say it this way. Christianity cannot simply be good people take care of themselves. Christianity cannot simply be that. Why, after all, do we have the picture of the body of Christ? We have in the New Testament the picture of the body of Christ because we need each other. The Apostle Paul, as we look at Colossians chapter 4, is a prisoner in the city of Rome.
This is the first of two imprisonments. And as we read the book of Colossians, and now the ending to the letter, we zoom in on the Christian family of this single man, Paul. And we get a brief picture of his friends.
If you think back to Colossians chapter 1, we can remember that it seems that Paul had never even met the folks at the church in Colossae. Yet Paul is interested in them, and in reading chapter 4, the way he reads this is he expects them to be interested in him as well. Further, he expects his letters that he writes to be read publicly at Colossae and at the neighboring churches. Paul is an apostle of Jesus Christ. He has been sent directly by Jesus to take the gospel to the Gentiles. He is the first person in New Testament history to have an international ministry. He had authority, and yet he is gracious while he is writing from prison. The best way to minister the sufficiency of Christ to others is with Christ-centered friends. I want to work through this text line by line like we normally do and use the friends that Paul mentions as marker posts along the way. So we start in verse 7. Tychicus will tell you all about my activities. He is a beloved brother and faithful minister and fellow servant in the Lord. What a description. Beloved brother, faithful minister, and fellow servant in the Lord. Verse 8, I have sent him to you for this very purpose, that you may know how we are and that he may encourage your hearts. Now, I had some letters delivered to my house yesterday, but I don't really know the mailman. And you can see that the letter carrier in Paul's day, this is Tychicus, the letter carrier, was often not just the deliverer of the letter, but the one who filled in the blanks. How is Paul really doing? Give me more details. He provided explanation on the letter, and we'll see that Tychicus is with Onesimus. Onesimus can help you answer some of these questions as well. Paul's first friend, Tychicus, was a faithful messenger. Tychicus will tell you all about my activities. As we were talking at the beginning, we actually believe Tychicus carried three letters. The book of Ephesians, the letter to the Ephesians, that's Ephesians chapter 6, verse 21. The letter to the Colossians, this letter. And then also the letter to Philemon, and Lord willing, we'll get into that in the future. Tychicus was a man with a servant's heart. Now, there isn't much in the Bible about Tychicus. I think he's mentioned 5 times. So we see through Paul's journey that Tychicus had stuck with Paul. He had known Paul. In Acts chapter 20, he went to Jerusalem with Paul. He had visited Paul while he was in prison in Rome. Further at the end of Titus chapter 3, it says this, when I sent Artemis or Tychicus to you, do your best to come to me at Nicopolis, for I have decided to spend the winter there. So it seems like Paul used Tychicus as a messenger to tell folks the news about him, to take these letters encouraging these churches. Tychicus was a big help to Paul in his ministry. Think about the journey from Rome to Colossae. That was a dangerous one, crossing Italy on foot, sailing across the Adriatic Sea, crossing Greece on foot, sailing again, and then journeying to Colossae. And as we say, there were no planes, trains, or automobiles, right? Paul trusted Tychicus. He called him a beloved brother, a faithful minister, and a fellow servant, a bond slave. That's the same word, servant, bond slave in the Lord. And he will tell you, Paul says, Tychicus will tell you how we are, and verse 8, he will encourage your hearts, that he may encourage your hearts. He has been faithful to me, Paul says, and he will be faithful to God's church. He will be faithful to you as well. I think encouragement was on Paul's heart. Look at Colossians 2, 1 and 2. For I want you to know how great a struggle I have for you, Paul writes to the church at Colossae, and for those at Laodicea, and for all who have not seen me face to face. He says, verse 2, that their hearts may be encouraged, being knit together in love, to reach all the riches of full assurance of understanding and the knowledge of God's mystery, which is Christ. I write this. I want you to be encouraged. Tychicus was a willing servant of God. We should be known by a desire to serve others. Am I willing to serve others? Are you willing to help others? Who knows what Tychicus's giftings were, but he was willing to help Paul to be his messenger, and he willingly accepted the task. Verse 9 tells us that Tychicus had a fellow traveler, and with him, Onesimus, our faithful and beloved brother, who is one of you. That means he's from Colossae. They will tell you of everything that has taken place here. Onesimus was a new brother in Christ. Onesimus was a new brother in Christ. We find out in the book of Philemon that Onesimus is a runaway slave who encountered Paul while Paul was imprisoned and was converted through the Apostle Paul's ministry. And Paul calls this slave Onesimus our faithful and beloved brother. He doesn't use the ministry language that he uses with others in this group, but he uses the same language that he does with his trusted friends. And we should not be surprised by this. Colossians chapter 3, verse 11. Here there is neither Greek or Jew, circumcised or uncircumcised, barbarian or Scythian, slave or free, but Christ is all and in all. Back to verse 9, Onesimus, who is one of you? He's a Colossian. His master was likely a member of the Colossian church. And Paul here includes him in his list of friends, this new believer. Paul likely found great encouragement in new converts. New friends can be a great encouragement. I had coffee with another ministry leader from the area this past week. And we were talking about the importance of new converts to a ministry. It's exciting to see new faces, exciting to see decisions for Christ, exciting to see people put their faith and trust in Jesus. I imagine that having Onesimus around was another great testimony for Paul to God's transforming power, what God can do to a life. We don't know what Onesimus did in his past. Had he stolen things? Had he done terrible things? We know that believers know that God can use people with a past. Paul continues on to talk about six individuals passing on their greetings. The first three are Jewish co-workers. The next three are Gentile co-workers. And we find five of the six of these names. I think it's Jesus, who they call Justice, who doesn't show up in the book of Philemon. This is verse 10. We read about Paul's Jewish co-workers first. Aristarchus, which is a Greek name, my fellow prisoner greets you. And Mark, the cousin of Barnabas, concerning whom you have received instructions, if he comes to you, welcome him. So we have Aristarchus, Mark, verse 11, and Jesus, who is called Justice. So he's going to make this comment about these men. These are the only men of the circumcision, the only Jewish co-workers among my fellow workers for the kingdom of God, and they have been a comfort to me. First, Aristarchus, my fellow prisoner. Aristarchus was a fellow prisoner. He was a Jew with a Greek name. And this is common in the dispersion. The Jews have been scattered all over the empire. Acts 19 lists Aristarchus as a traveling companion of Paul's at Ephesus. And the following chapter, Acts chapter 20, tells us that Aristarchus is from Thessalonica. Paul calls Aristarchus a fellow prisoner. It seems, if you read Acts chapter 19 in Ephesus, that Aristarchus is arrested there. We don't know how Aristarchus ends up in prison. If Paul writes Colossians from Rome, which we think is likely, how did he end up at Rome in prison with Paul? And many scholars guess that Aristarchus likely went to prison voluntarily to provide companionship for Paul. It's a pretty noble thing. Look at the end of verse 11. These are the only men of the circumcision among my fellow workers for the kingdom of God, and they have been a comfort to me. Paul, no doubt, found encouragement from sharing in the trials with this man. We are in prison together, my fellow prisoner. And I think there are some points of application that we can make here. There are advantages to sharing circumstances with others. We should not be cliquish or snobby, but that doesn't mean that we don't have more in common with some people than others. That's just common sense. And we often find greater comfort with those who better understand our situation. I think Paul's kind of saying that here. My fellow Jewish comrades, my fellow prisoner has provided comfort for me. These men have been a comfort to me. I think about this from another angle. Think about the body of Christ. We have a special stewardship of the gifts, of the commonalities that we have with others, where we live, what education we have, even our age and family size. Those can be commonalities that God can use to help us share the gospel with others and certainly be encouraging to others. I know what you're going through. I went through that. That's very difficult. Very difficult. But God is good. And saying that truth, we must also be aware that the biggest difference between Christians and the world is that our friendships are not limited to people who are like us. Paul was friends with both Jews and Gentiles. After Aristarchus is Mark. Mark, it says, the cousin of Barnabas. So they must have known who Barnabas was. And then we have this parenthetical phrase there, concerning whom you have received instructions, if he comes to you, welcome him. Now, if you know Paul's story from the book of Acts, then you know that Mark, John Mark, had a checkered past with Paul. We see in the book of Acts that the early Christians met in Mark's mother's house. Further, Paul and Barnabas, that's Paul's first missionary journey, Paul and Barnabas took Mark with them on the first journey, and apparently when the journey became difficult, Mark abandoned them. And this actually caused division between Paul and Barnabas, because when it was time to go on their second journey, Paul wanted to take Barnabas and Barnabas wanted to take Mark, and Paul said, no way. And so Paul ended up taking Silas. There was some division over Mark. But this greeting here in Colossians chapter 4 and a passage that we find in 2 Timothy chapter 4 verse 11 indicates that Paul and Mark must have been reconciled. This is 2 Timothy chapter 4, and we think this is written at the end of Paul's life, so probably 3 or 4 years at least later after this. It says, Luke alone is with me. We'll come back to Luke. Get Mark and bring him with you. And then Paul says this, for he is very useful to me for ministry. Went from Mark is kind of worthless, like we're not taking him with me, to now Mark is useful for the ministry. Paul and Mark must have reconciled. Their relationship must have been restored. We also know that Peter, at the end of 1 Peter, he mentions Mark, and so Mark must have had a ministry in the city of Rome. Bible scholars believe that Mark, and if you know Matthew Mark, right, the second gospel, that's this guy, John Mark. They think that he wrote Mark from Rome, and then look back at Colossians 4, verse 10. Mark, the cousin of Barnabas, concerning whom you have received instructions. So we don't know what the instructions are. The Bible doesn't tell us. We just know that Mark was to be welcome there in the Colossian church. As I mentioned, they seem to know who Barnabas was, the cousin of Barnabas. Interestingly, the Bible does not say much about Barnabas, really anything at all other than mentioning his name here, after Paul and Barnabas separate on their missionary journey. Mark was a restored friend to the Apostle Paul. Christians should know better than anyone else that relationships can be restored. The basis for relationship restoration is the forgiveness that we find in Jesus Christ. Colossians chapter 3, verses 12 and 13. Put on then as God's chosen ones, holy and beloved, compassionate hearts, kindness, humility, meekness, and patience, bearing with one another, and if one has a complaint against another, right? And when one has a complaint against another, forgiving each other. As the Lord has forgiven you, so you also must forgive. I think it's worth noting that the church, even in Paul's day, wasn't populated with perfect people. And it is true for today as well. Our church is not populated with perfect people. Even pastors are not perfect. I know that's hard to believe, but it is true. When we are wronged, we must recall our own wrongs against God. We have perspective. We need forgiveness too, so we give our forgiveness to others. Paul begins this list of folks sending greetings with three Jewish folks. We find the third one in verse 11, Aristarchus, Mark, and then Jesus, who is called Justice, was a Jewish fellow worker. Jesus was a common name in that day and time. And so with Jesus, the Messiah, coming to prominence, folks who are called Jesus are going to take on other names. This man, surnamed Justice. And we don't know much about him, the Jesus who is called Justice in verse 11. This verse certainly doesn't tell us much. We know he was a fellow worker with Paul. We know he was a comfort to him. We see that in verse 11. And as we read verse 11, we are reminded that the Jews have largely rejected the message that Paul is proclaiming. He's saying, these three men are the only Jews that have stood with me. These three men have stood with me while I've preached the message of the gospel that is good for the Gentile world to be accepted in. I wonder how these three men comforted Paul. The text doesn't tell us specifically. Through their labor, through their personal ministry, through their camaraderie, we're not exactly sure. Three Jews, and then we're going to see three Gentiles that Paul mentions in verses 12 through 14 that send their greetings to the church at Colossae. Epaphras, and we've heard of him. He's in chapter 1. Epaphras, who is one of you, a servant of Christ Jesus, greets you. And then pay attention here. This is neat. Always struggling. It's the word for wrestling. Always wrestling on your behalf in his prayers, that you may stand mature and fully assured in all the will of God. For I bear him witness that he has worked hard for you. Paul says, I vouch for him, all right? I speak for him. I bear witness that he has worked hard for you and for those in Laodicea and those in Hierapolis. Verse 14, Luke, the beloved physician, greets you, as does Demas. So these three guys are the Gentiles, Epaphras, Luke, and Demas. First, Epaphras was a devoted pastor. Epaphras was a devoted pastor. I mentioned he shows up in chapter 1. We think he is the pastor at the church at Colossae, verses 7 and 8 of chapter 1. Epaphras, our beloved fellow servant, is a faithful minister of Christ on your behalf and has made known to us your love in the Spirit. Epaphras had told Paul, these are the false teachings that are taking place at the church at Laodicea, the church at Colossae. What should I say to them? Please give me instruction to give back to them. Paul had identified Epaphras as a faithful minister of Christ in chapter 1. In chapter 4, he is a servant of Christ Jesus. He is doing the sorts of things that Paul was doing for this church as well. He was always in prayer, seeking after their maturity, seeking after their fullness in Christ. He says that you may be fully assured in all the will of God. The false teachers were saying, you can't find your fullness in Christ. You need to do these other things. And Paul says, no, you find your fullness. We're praying that you find your fullness in Christ. Epaphras had come to Rome. That's where Paul's writing this letter from prison, to tell Paul the troubles that are going on in Colossae. And Paul is writing this letter to the Colossians in answer to what Epaphras had told him. And apparently Epaphras wants to spend more time with Paul. He doesn't travel back with the letter. So Paul says he sends his greetings as well. I pointed out verse 12 a little more closely. Epaphras struggles on your behalf in his prayers. That word struggles is the word for wrestle. It comes from the Greek word that leads to our word agonize. He agonizes in his knees, on his knees in fervent prayer. Epaphras agonizes in fervent prayer. It's quite the picture, always struggling on your behalf in his prayers. I keep reading verses from Colossians. This is chapter 4, verse 2. Continue steadfast in prayer, being watchful in it with thanksgiving. Epaphras is praying that you may stand mature and fully assured in all the will of God. Don't you think every pastor in the world should have the same desire? That his people be mature and convinced of the truth? That his people stand in the truth? That his people are convinced of the will of God? I think we should notice that the content of Epaphras' prayer is spiritual. It's fine to pray for physical things. It's fine. But I think sometimes it becomes a distraction or maybe an excuse for not praying or caring about people's spiritual welfare. And we see Epaphras praying fervently, agonizing in prayer over the spiritual well-being of the church at Colossae. Paul writes, verse 13, "I bear witness. I vouch for Epaphras that he is working hard for you, that he is laboring for you." Perhaps there was stress involved for Epaphras in being concerned about the spiritual welfare of others. It's a lot to bear. Those folks had to choose what they were going to follow, what they were going to believe. We see the end of this verse that Epaphras is concerned also about the church at Laodicea and Hierapolis. Laodicea, we mentioned this at the beginning of the book, was about 12 miles west of Colossae. Hierapolis is about 15 miles northwest of Colossae. All three towns are on important Roman roads. It's possible, so again, some guessing, that Epaphras started churches in each of these three towns. And there's some conjecture about why Hierapolis isn't mentioned till this point in the book. And I think, at least the commentaries I read, they think that maybe the false teaching hadn't made it to Hierapolis. The false teaching had just made it to Colossae and Laodicea. Epaphras is the first Gentile mentioned in this list of Paul's co-workers, but there are two more. Verse 14, "Luke, the beloved physician, greets you, as does Demas." Have you heard Luke referred to as the beloved physician? All right, that's a common description of Luke. And that comes right from this text, Colossians chapter 4, verse 14. This is where we find out that Luke is a doctor. Luke, the beloved physician. Dr. Luke wrote the second largest amount of text in the New Testament next to Paul. He wrote almost one-fourth of the New Testament in Luke and Acts. He authored those two books. We actually don't find Luke's name very many places in the New Testament. He's mentioned here and in the book of Philemon. We also find him, and I read his name earlier, in 2 Timothy chapter 4, verse 11, at the very end of Paul's life. Colossians 4, this text tells us that Luke was a Gentile and a doctor, and he seems to be a regular companion of Paul's. Now, we can guess all day long about these characters and what their lives were like. We don't have a lot of information to go off, but you have to wonder, what did Luke, the beloved physician, give up? Did he have a successful practice? Did he have a family? Was he needed in the area where he was serving? What did he give up to accompany the Apostle Paul? Certainly Luke was a cultured and educated man who would have been a good friend to the Apostle Paul in his travels. It seems from 2 Timothy chapter 4 that Luke is the only one with Paul, the only one with Paul at the end of his life. He says, "Luke alone is with me." Luke, the beloved physician, and then as does Demas. And Demas does show up other places in the New Testament. He shows up again in Philemon. He shows up again in 2 Timothy. And not much here. And so you see on the outline there, Demas was a, and I put in parentheses, future question mark, disappointment. There's about 3 to 4 years from Colossians to the writing of 2 Timothy, we think. And Paul's going to write something negative about Demas when he writes 2 Timothy. And so did Demas forsake him between now and then, or was it earlier? And was Paul not sure yet? You know, we're not sure what he knows. But here he lists Demas as a fellow worker, a Gentile fellow worker. We don't know much about him. He's mentioned again in Philemon verse 24. 2 Timothy 4 verse 10 provides some additional information. This is what it says, 2 Timothy 4:10. "For Demas, in love with this present world, has deserted me and gone to Thessalonica." For Demas, having loved this present world, has deserted me and gone to Thessalonica. We don't have a book on the life of Demas. We just have this one verse. It seems like Demas abandoned both Paul and the gospel. It sounds like he was pretending that his love was something other than it truly was. This is a sad note at the end of the book of 2 Timothy. One of Paul's co-workers, one of his friends, has deserted him, having loved this present world. We just talked about restoration, but I think this person, this friend of Paul's, I think this is another important principle. It demonstrates to us not every relationship can be restored. We are to offer forgiveness and seek restoration, but sometimes there is a difference of values that makes restoration impossible. Demas was a future disappointment, for the Apostle Paul. Now verse 15, give my greetings to the brothers at Laodicea and to Nympha and the church in her house. Here Paul offers his own greeting in verse 15, give my greeting. Perhaps he is encouraging the church at Colossae to be in fellowship with the church at Laodicea. And then we find Nympha, the host of a church. Nympha was the host of a church. It's interesting, isn't it, to remind ourselves that the churches in Paul's day met in houses. It wasn't until sometime later that church buildings were developed. And I believe I was asked at the beginning of the study who the only female lady was in the book of Colossians, and Nympha is probably the answer, right? So we see from the ESV that they put her house, so they're interpreting Nympha to be a lady. The versions that interpret Nympha to be a man would put an S at the end of the name. So we don't know for sure, but the best guess today is that Nympha was the lady hostess of this early church, Nympha. She gave of her possessions. She provided a place for worship for this church. Perhaps she is a wealthy widow, and it sounds like she lived in the town of Laodicea. She gave of what she had to help the gospel advance. Verse 16, Paul continues, and when this letter has been read among you, have it also read in the church of the Laodiceans, and see that you also read the letter from Laodicea. Does that raise some questions in your mind? So what letter? There's no book of Laodiceans, right? There's no book like that. In Paul's day, copies of texts were not easy to come by. Of course, they didn't have Xerox machines, right, or copy machines, or scanners. Further, not all people were literate, right? Not all people were able to read. And so public readings were very important. Paul requests in verse 16 an exchange of letters. Perhaps they made a copy, perhaps they took the original, we don't know. So to what Laodicean letter, have it also read in the church of the Laodiceans and see that you also read the letter from Laodicea. What letter is Paul talking about? The answer is, we're not sure. Some people guess that it's the letter to the Ephesian church. The book of Ephesians was written as a circular letter. I was listening to some sermons on this text, and the pastor said that the book of Ephesians, in some cases, has a blank where it says to the church at Ephesus. It was meant to be a letter that circulated. But if you remember earlier, it's Epaphras carried the letter to the Ephesians, the letter to the Colossians, and the letter to Philemon. So why did they have to exchange letters unless maybe he'd already delivered that letter or he delivered it on another trip? So there's a lot of things that we don't know. Paul says, swap letters. Make sure that you read all the truths that I'm providing here. And then verse 17, and say to Archippus. I do think this is maybe the most practical verse of this list here. And say to Archippus, see that you fulfill the ministry that you have received in the Lord. What was that ministry? Again, it doesn't tell us. Now, Archippus was a fellow soldier, verse 17. Archippus was a fellow soldier. Now, where do you get that, Pastor? Philemon, verse 2, mentions Archippus as our fellow soldier. And there is much mystery here as well. Apparently, Archippus was given a task. See that you fulfill your task, the one that you have received in the Lord. Make sure that you do it. And I said, why not? You know, we can put our name here, right? Say, Christian, see that you fulfill the task. Christian, see that you fulfill the ministry that you have received in the Lord. The best way to minister the sufficiency of Christ to others is with Christ-centered friends. Paul did not forget his friends. The kingdom cannot be advanced without a little help from our friends. Whatever your area of ministry, wherever God has put you, we have to be faithful. How is God going to use me this year? How is God going to use you this year? It may mean working with someone. Well, I don't work well with anyone. Well, maybe there's some room for some self-examination then. We are an independent Baptist church. And there's some good reasons to be that. But we should never be completely independent. Our hearts should be bound together on the things that really matter. I can tell you from practical experience, and I bet you would tell me the same thing, that you cannot determine how others will care for you.
You cannot determine how others will care for you. You can only determine how you will care for others. Listen to what Paul is saying. The best way to minister the sufficiency of Christ to others is with Christ-centered friends. And there's one more verse. I didn't forget about it. Verse 18. I, Paul, write this greeting with my own hand. Remember my chains. Grace be with you. Paul ends this book with an apostolic signature, a final prayer request, and a wish for grace. It was common for letters in Paul's day to be dictated to scribes who wrote in smaller letters because the parchments they wrote on were valuable, and then to be signed at the end by the author. Paul writes, the gospel is advancing, but there are still difficulties. Remember my chains. Remember me in prayer. And finally, grace be with you. Grace be with you. May you fully understand the sufficiency of Jesus Christ in your comings and goings, in your family, in your relationships. I, Paul, write this greeting with my own hand. Remember my chains. Grace be with you. Let's close in prayer. Father, we thank you for this time, the opportunity to open your truth, to open your word. We ask that we would be challenged by this text. Paul in the Bible is the Apostle Paul. He had a lot more authority than any of us. And yet his friendships were powerful. His friendships are important to his ministry. God, I ask that you would help us as we work together with others, that we would be we would be honest about the gospel, that we wouldn't undermine the gospel in our friendships and relationships. We would also not let our personal flaws or preferences get in the way of what you have for our lives. God, I ask that you would help us to make much of your truth. Remember that God is greater than man. That we would seek to be faithful in the task that you've given us. In Jesus' name, amen. I want us to close just a chorus. I know a fount where sins are washed away. I think that's wrong.
I know a fount where sins are washed away. I know a place where night is turned to day. Burdens are lifted, blind eyes made to see. There's a wonder-working power in the blood of Calvary.
Our Father, we know a place where forgiveness is offered, where a relationship with God is offered. God, I ask that your sufficiency, the sufficiency of the death of your Son, Jesus Christ, that would change our lives, transform our lives, transform our relationships in our homes and our places of work. I ask that we would do the right thing for the right reason. We would seek to know who we are, your children, that would be an important truth to us today. I pray that our hearts would be sensitive. We are sinners. It's hard for us to admit that we did wrong. God, I ask that we would come to you humbly, again and again, seeking your face, knowing that you will forgive us our sins, knowing that we have hope of seeing you face to face someday. God, I thank you for your truth. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you for coming this morning.